Have you ever been around a woman giving birth? Or maybe you yourself have given birth? All of us have at least seen births depicted on TV. And few sounds capture a groan like birth pangs. It's the raw sound of life and birth, as well as pain. It contains the deep desire for the end of the waiting for what has been anticipated and desired. For any who have been present through such an event, it is difficult to ever forget. It is in equal parts beautiful, stunning, and holy, as well as raw, painful, and horrific. In our reading for today, Paul writes to the congregation in Rome. He says, "Creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves groan inwardly while we wait for God." Paul describes it so well, that painful wail of our souls for the redemption and the restoration of all things. It's like this pandemic. Even the most patient of us are at the ends of our ropes. Just think, it's been over a year now that we've been social distancing, wearing masks, and using Zoom and Skype as the only way to stay connected to some of our loved ones. We've been groaning for over a year. Just like those birth cries, it has been equal parts painful and horrific, as well as beautiful and holy. As we begin to come out of our shelters and mingle again in the ways we did before, let us remember the beautiful and holy things this intense waiting has brought about. Remember the kindness shown to you. Remember the joy of reconnecting through Zoom and phone calls with people you hadn't spoken to in years, because now you had the time to do that. Remember the holiness of listening to the outside world, a world that became quieter, that enabled us to hear nature in new ways and to see mountains that once had been covered with pollution become clear again. Remember the extra work our teachers did to provide education and stability for our youth. Remember the sacrifice so many health workers and essential workers made. We have grown together as a people of God, waiting with hope for healing to come to our scarred world. The whole of creation groans for its restoration. We join this creation waiting for our own hearts, souls, and bodies to be restored. We know this is coming, and we groan for it. While we groan, we are given a midwife, a spirit of God, to join us in our waiting for the birth of a new world and a new reality. This gift is given this day, the day of Pentecost. Anthropologists describe fire as one of the markers of the human species. For tens of thousands of years, humans gathered around fire for light, for warmth, for protection and community, and for better food. Many passages in the Bible liken God to fire. The Holy Spirit of God appeared on Sinai in flames of fire, which on Pentecost appeared on the head of each believer. Moses experienced God in fire. Through the fire, the Israelites presented offerings to God. God led the people through the wilderness with a pillar of fire. And seraphim are fire spirits, extensions of the divine. Think fire, think God. I have a few science experiments that I'll share with you throughout this video that show really how amazing the gift of fire really is.
Rosenberg's H-bomb, Sugar Ray, Pamela, John Brando, the King and I, and the catcher in the rye, Eisenhower, Maxine.
When the Feast of the Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. Then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks. And they started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then when they heard one after another their own mother tongues being spoken, they were thunderstruck. They couldn't for the life of them figure out what was going on and kept saying, "Aren't these the Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues?" Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head or tail of any of it. They talked back and forth, confused. "What's going on here?" Others joked, "They're drunk on cheap wine." And that's when Peter stood up and, backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency. "Fellow Jews! All of you who are visiting Jerusalem, listen carefully and get this story straight. These people aren't drunk, as some of you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your young men will see visions. Your old men dream dreams. When the time comes, I'll pour out my spirit on those who serve me, men and women both, and they'll prophesy. I'll set wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and billowing smoke. The sun turned black and the moon blood red. For the day of the Lord arrives, the day tremendous and marvelous, and whoever calls out for help to me, God, will be saved."
Here's something. If you want a candle, but you don't have a candle, but you happen to have the Crayola crayon, you can make yourself a candle. It'll burn 2 to 3 hours. In case you want to read by the firelight, but you don't have any firelight, you can read by the Crayola.
Know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. Not only so, but ourselves also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for that which he sees? But if we hope for that which we don't see, we wait for it with patience. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weaknesses, for we don't know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings which can't be uttered. He who searches the hearts knows what is on the Spirit's mind, because he makes intercession for the saints according to God.
We are
Did you ever catch fireflies when you were a kid? I have some great memories of catching some of those fireflies on warm summer evenings a long time ago, and then putting them in a mason jar to keep for at least a little while. And whether we called them fireflies or lightning bugs, we saw their tiny lights as one of the marks of summertime. Fireflies. You probably haven't thought about that before, but now that you do, chances are your answer is something like, well, it's been a long time, or I really can't remember when. That's not because you've become less observant. Experts think that fireflies are dwindling by as much as 70% in recent years. To see fireflies now, you might have to drive for miles to get away from the lights of the city. We in the Midwest can enjoy fireflies, but in Thailand, there are so many fireflies that there are stretches of riverbank that light up at night like a Christmas light display that's synchronized with music. The lights come from those fireflies are so bright that they can help boats navigate their way through the pitch black night. On and off, tens of thousands of tiny lights flash, all in perfect unison. It's a wonder of the world, one that scientists have been studying for a couple generations now. There's no one firefly keeping time or sending out signals that tell the other thousands of fireflies what to do. They just do it. And the result is enough light to navigate a winding river. It's amazing to us, but it's just how the fireflies are made, to light up the night together. Speaking of light bearers, note that today is Pentecost, the anniversary of that day when the Holy Spirit came in a mighty way upon the disciples of Jesus. The description says this: divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. The fact that these tongues of fire rested on each of Jesus' followers on Pentecost is a way of showing that when the Spirit fills us, we too radiate the light of God. Followers of Jesus are like lightning bugs. We're light bearers. And over the centuries, Christians have glowed with that light as they have shared the good news, gone about doing good, committed sacrificial acts of love for neighbor and even for enemies. Sometimes, though, shining our light, showing our Pentecost power, is difficult. It's hard because we've gotten it into our heads that it's this little light of mine and I have to let it shine. It's a lot of pressure to create light out of nothing or out of our interior life and shine it into the immense darkness of the world. It feels almost pointless. None of us are really sure what it means to let my light shine in everyday life. How do I generate my light and shine it at work, at school, on the morning commute, or at the dinner table? Well, Scripture gives us some pointers. When we do justice, when we feed the hungry and free the captive and house the homeless, even at cost to ourselves, our light will break forth like the dawn. Not just when we pray for the hungry, but when we share our food with them. Not just when we donate to a group that helps the homeless, but when we bring them into our house. Not just when we group people together and call them the hungry and the homeless and the sick, as if people can be defined by their circumstance, but when we recognize them as us, our kin, our family, fellow children of God, worthy of love and hope and dignity and food and shelter and health care and meaningful work. When we erase the boundaries and all people are loved, not just with feelings, but with actions, then our light will be as bright as the noon sun and we'll find that God is right by our side. We're created to shine together, not just as individuals, but as the whole body of Christ. One firefly is fun and pretty, grows dim if it continues to be the only one. 10,000 fireflies, all shining their lights in unison, like in Thailand, can illuminate the darkness like nothing we've ever seen. It takes work to get to the point of all of us working toward the same goal. But imagine if we were all sharing the same good news that God is love, that grace abounds, maybe our lights could shine together rather than one at a time. And we might just find that the light could illuminate the darkness like nothing we've ever seen. It would be amazing to behold, but we would just be like the fireflies, doing what we were made to do. Author Marianne Williamson says, as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. This is exactly what scientists think happens with fireflies. One wakes up, then others around it join in, and more join in until everyone's rhythm is so perfectly synchronized that you can't tell where it began. It's not that there's a leader as much as that there was one firefly willing to get the ball rolling, and pretty soon everyone had permission to let the light shine. The light's not just in some of us, it's in all of us, planted there by the one who created light and called us to live as children of light. And we were born to let it shine. So when God calls, asking for someone to throw off the bushel basket and let their light shine, who will answer? We will. Because deep down, that's what we were made to do. The power of Pentecost came as a flame that rested on everyone that day. And the power rests upon us now too. Let your light shine and let us start the world on fire.
Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire.
The next time we gather at the table, the wine will be the sweetest we've tasted, and the bread the most satisfying, and yet will not compare to the company we share as we gather together. The next time we send our kids to school, we will weep when we say goodbye, and we will send thank you notes to teachers that we've owed them for decades. The next time we embrace our friends and families, we will feel it in every fiber of our being, bursting with gratitude, fully present, with tears of joy in our eyes. The next time we dance at the club, we will dance like it's our last, and tip our bartenders and servers their just pay, and our feet will be sore from all of the dance, and all our throats from all the laughter, and our faces from the unstoppable smiling. And when we sing together hymns, songs from live bands, the beat of the DJ, feeling the very thing that makes us human, we will come alive from a dormancy that will surprise us all as between notes we find the largest collective sigh of relief. We will cough our freedom forth as our lungs remember how to share the breath of God again. Christ is risen, just as he said. Go in peace, share the good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God.